and my colleagues and all the friends present here. Today we are going to talk on assisted reproductive techniques, a peephole to the future. We are going to briefly touch on what are the new modalities available with us today and where do they stand in these times ethically and medically. First of all, if we look at the definition of infertility in the current scenario, we need to revise this definition. We all know that infertility, historically, we have been defining it as the failure to achieve pregnancy after 12 months of unprotected and frequent intercourse in the context of regular ovulation and in a woman whose age less than 37 years. But in some cases where the couples who do not fall into the above criteria, we should have a different definition. We should recourse to earlier treatments in a woman who is 37 or more, who has risk factors for infertility, and these risk factors are irregular ovulation, pelvic pathology like tubal blockage, a family history of premature menopause, where her mother or her sisters have had a cessation of menses before 40 years of age, or if there is a risk of male infertility, or if there is like male infertility, a severe male infertility problem like a severe oligospermia or azoospermia. So in these circumstances, we do not wait for 12 months. We can refer this patient for assisted reproduction even earlier at 6 months or even immediately whenever the patient is coming to us. Now, the first IVF baby was born in 1978. And in its 4-decade history, ART has improved so much, it has improved continuously, but still there are a lot of challenges. Still we do have patients with recurrent implantation failures and pregnancy rates we have risen slowly, but still it is still low. The pregnancy rate, 40-50%, the best of patients would be considered still low. And ART is at a point where the practice will change substantially in the times to come. Now, looking at the female partner, in the female partner, the biggest threats to fertility are, number one is maternal age. After the age of 37 years, there is a sharp decline in the fertility of the females. And the factors which contribute to this decline are the aging, DNA, increased fertilization failures, decreased implantation rates, increased risk of miscarriage, increased risk of genetic anomalies in the babies, requirement of donor oocytes, sometimes when the AMH is very low, or after menopause, the patient will not conceive with their own oocytes, he will need a donor oocyte. And the second biggest challenge these days is maternal obesity, because obesity overall is increasing, especially in Southeast Asia, and we see a lot of polycystic ovarian disease these days. So obesity is a very big challenge, and obesity also leads to decreased implantation rates and increased risk of miscarriages. Now when the couple, infertile couple comes to the OPD, so there are four important things that have to be seen. Number one is the ovarian reserve. Ovarian reserve will depend on the mother, age of the mother, and then her ultrasound, the volume of ovaries on ultrasound, the number of antral follicles that can be counted in both the ovaries on ultrasound. And another important test which we have with us these days is anti-ovarian hormone, which is a very good indicator of ovarian reserve. So this is very important. Ovarian reserve is the most important thing in planning what treatment to decide for a patient. And once we've decided to go for IVF, then what stimulation protocol has to be given to the patient, so that it is efficacious as well as safe for her. The second important assessment is an ovulation study. Ovulation study to see the development of the follicles, the rupture of the follicles, for looking at the endometrium. And this is an important thing in the ovulation study, which is a most important part of any IVF cycle or any fertility treatment. And the third assessment is the pelvic assessment. Pelvic assessment for pelvic inflammatory disease, endometriosis, tubal patency, and minimal endometriosis, minimal PID, there are certain tuberculosis, and certain things can be corrected before a person goes for IVF or any fertility treatment. And tubal patency test is one of the most important tests. Once the patient even a subfertile patient or a patient who has unexplained infertility where all the rest is normal, an HSG, a hysterosalpingography, or a tubal patency with laparoscopy is a very important test. And last but not the least is the sperm testing. Sperm testing in most of the female infertile patients, just a Suman analysis done on the WHO criteria would be enough. If we know that the fault lies with the lady, there is a tubal blockage or ovarian reserve is not good, or there is some problem with ovulation, then such couples, a good WHO criteria semen analysis which shows a normal report is enough. We do not need to do any further testing in such cases. But in patients who have a male factor infertility or patients who have an azoospermia or severe oligospermia, so we have a battery of tests for such patients which include, the important ones would include a hormonal test, which is a follicle stimulating hormone test. The second would be an ultrasound of the scrotum and a transrectal ultrasound. And the third would be a surgical sperm retrieval. In cases of azoospermia, we want to know whether there is sperm formation happening inside the testes or when. So a surgical sperm retrieval. This is the list, these are the four tests which are important and they tell us almost everything about a male patient. Now, in the last decade, we are seeing a lot of changes happening in the practice, in the way ART being practiced. These years, we are seeing a shift from a day 2 to day 3 embryo transfer to a day 5 transfer. A day 2, day 3 transfer is a cleavage stage embryo which has 8 cells. And day 5, day 6, you have a complete blastocyst. So once an embryo reaches a day 5, day 6 blastocyst stage, the probability of it surviving in the uterus is more. So we can reduce the number of embryos transferred if we have a blastocyst embryo. We can either put one, that is the ideal, if we put just one blastocyst, that's the ideal case. Or if you don't have good blastocyst, we can increase the number, 2, but not more than 3. The second thing that is being done these days is a single embryo transfer. Single blastocyst, a good blastocyst, single embryo we transfer, and rest of the embryos, they are frozen for future use. And the third thing which is coming these 8 days in a big way in the conferences that I attended this year and last year, a lot of talk on freeze all embryos. So many people are of the view that we should not transfer an embryo in the cycle where we have done an ovarian stimulation. Ovarian stimulation is going to do something to the endometrium which is not good for implantation. It is going to mature the endometrium prematurely. Premature LH surge and premature luteinization of the endometrium, that would give us a negative IVF result. So many people think that we should freeze all the embryos. Just make the embryos in one cycle, stimulate the ovaries, do an oocyte retrieval, make the embryos and freeze all the embryos. And then you transfer the embryos in a natural cycle or in an artificially prepared cycle. That has been reported and even we see in the regular IVF practice that a frozen embryo transfer cycle gives a better result, it is safe for the patient. And it gives a lower risk pregnancy. Even the risk of eclampsia, hypertension, IUGR has been reported to be lower in the frozen embryo cycles than the fresh embryo transfer cycles. Another important technique that we have these days is in vitro maturation. In which vitro maturation is a procedure where we are not taking a mature oocyte from the ovary. We are not giving a trigger of ovulation. We are giving a 7-8 days of ovarian stimulation. Then we take out the immature oocytes. Then we mature these sites in the lab. We give the HCG in the lab, in the culture media. And this procedure is good for PCOS patients. Sometimes few patients, there is a subset of patients that would not respond very well to the conventional ovarian stimulation. They will not give us a very good oocyte quality by the conventional method. So in these patients, if we take out the immature oocytes and we mature them in the lab, it gives us a better quality of oocytes. And it is very safe also because this patient would never go into a hyperstimulation syndrome. Another important thing that we see these days is the regulation. Like we see surrogacy has been banned for the foreigners and for international patients. So in the coming years, ART is going to be regulated. We are going to have an ART law in the country. And it may prohibit the use of donor oocytes, and it may restrict surrogacy to a very few subset of patients. So it is the time to go in for new things and to look beyond conventional IVF so that we can offer something better to our patients. And if we don't have donor eggs, if we don't have surrogates, then what to do in such patients? This we are going to discuss. And then another important thing is fertility preservation. Fertility preservation is preserving fertility in cancer patients who have to go for chemotherapy. Because after chemotherapy, radiotherapy, we all know that the rapidly dividing cells would be most affected. And after chemo, we may not have the same ovary, the same oocyte. So what can we do? What can be done to preserve fertility in cancer patients? Another important problem these days, modern times, sometimes ladies, they are going for all sorts of careers. They don't want to marry before 40. They don't find a suitable partner before 40. Or even if they marry, they don't want to plan a family. They don't want to have a baby till they are settled in their careers or till they have done with their careers, especially ladies in the Bollywood and all. They would not like to have a baby before 40. So what to do for them? So there is something for them also. And then another important procedure for male infertility, which is now considered to be the treatment of choice in cases of non-obstructive azoospermia, that is microdissection, TESI. So we are going to briefly touch upon these things and see where they stand. Now briefly about assisted reproduction. Assisted reproduction is the method where we are handling the oocyte gametes in the laboratory, outside the body. Any procedure in which we are handling the oocytes outside the body is called assisted reproduction. And it involves these six steps. The first step is ovarian stimulation. Ovarian stimulation is done to recover a number of oocytes, more number of oocytes. Like we want 8 to 10 oocytes, so we need to stimulate the ovary because a natural cycle will just give us one oocyte. So that's the need for ovarian stimulation. Oocyte retrieval, this is done under ultrasound guidance, and the oocytes are retrieved from the ovary under short delay, a simple procedure. Then sperm collection. Sperm collection in a normal patient, sperm collection by masturbation, and in a patient of azoospermia, it's a surgical sperm retrieval. The third is the handling of gametes in the lab, handling by either in vitro fertilization or intracytoplasmic sperm injection, depending on the counts and depending on the problems. In patients where the sperm has been retrieved surgically or where the count is less than 5 billion, intracytoplasmic sperm injection is the treatment of choice because IVF would lead to a failed fertilization. So ICSI is done in these cases. Then after but IVF and ICSI, you assess the next day whether the eggs have fertilized, whether the embryos are coming up, then second day, third day, fourth day, fifth day, you follow the embryo and then you do the embryo transfer. After embryo transfer, whatever surplus embryo, good quality embryo remain with you, they can be frozen. So that's called embryo freezing. Now coming to ovarian stimulation, now this is the most tricky part of any fertility treatment because we still do not have an IVF protocol that would ensure an adequate number of oocyte embryos with good implantation potential, any protocol which would totally eliminate ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome, and that also gives us uterine environment, a conducive uterine environment. And last but not the least is the term pregnancy, singleton term pregnancy. So we are still looking for such a protocol. But to individualize the treatment protocol according to the patient is the most important thing, and this is what we should practice in our OPDs. First of all, among the female patients, we have to identify whether she is a normal responder or a poor responder or a hyper responder. In a normal responder, The age would be less than 37. She would be having regular menstrual cycles. Her ovaries would look normal on ultrasound with like 10 to 12 antral follicles on both the sides. Her anti-Müllerian hormone would be within the normal range, that is from 2 to 4. So this is a normal patient with a normal rate. A normal responder is different from a poor responder. Now poor responder we are going to take up later. A hyper responder is a patient who has big ovaries, too many antral follicles, typical necklace appearance of ovary that we look in the books where the stromal echoes are very bright and the follicles are arranged at the periphery, and it's a big ovary, volume is big, and this patient is a hyper responder because her ovary will just blow up. After just 2-3 injections of gonadotropin, she is going to make too many eggs. So this is the most difficult patient to handle, hyper responder. For hyper responder patients, the best protocol is a GnRH antagonist protocol. This is the patient who has highest risk of going into hyperstimulation, which is a life-threatening syndrome. So never in such a patient we should go for agonist and HCG trigger. Always give an antagonist protocol and give her an agonist trigger. So such a patient would never go into hyperstimulation, and even after the stimulation and IVF, if we do not place any embryo in the fresh cycle, we are freezing all the embryos for her and we are transferring her embryos in a natural cycle. So this is a guarantee she will never have a hyperstimulation syndrome, neither the early hyperstimulation syndrome nor the late hyperstimulation syndrome. Now, the second category which is tricky is the hyporesponder. Hyporesponder, there is a criteria which has been identified to help us in identifying which of our patients are hyporesponders. Hyporesponders, they would usually be at an advanced age, which is more than 40 years of age. And sometimes we have a history that this lady has responded poorly to a conventional stimulation protocol. She has been given a stimulation protocol and but she has made only less than 3 or only 3 oocytes. So this is a poor responder. And another AMH helps us. If the AMH is less than 5, if it is between 0.5 to 1.1, then she falls into a hyporesponder. Now that was about the female patient because we do have just 4-5 gynecologists in the gathering, so I don't think I should can have another lecture for that. Coming to the male factor, the severe male factor, so there are 3 kinds of problems. One is severe oligozoospermia, second is non-obstructive azoospermia, and the third is obstructive azoospermia. ICSI is used in such cases after we have been able to surgically retrieve sperms, and ICSI was first reported in 1993. And till late, we were doing surgical sperm retrieval with either a PISA. PISA is a percutaneous epididymal surgical sperm aspiration. And another technique that we were using was TESI. TESI was testicular sperm extraction. So both of these were blind procedures. We were just putting a needle from the skin. And the retrieval rate in obstructive azoospermia is usually good with it, but it is not good in non-obstructive azoospermia, because in patients with non-obstructive azoospermia, there is focal spermatogenesis. The spermatogenesis is not happening throughout the tissue. So if your needle by chance goes into an area which is fibrotic, you will not retrieve any sperms. So this microdissection TESI is a new procedure which has come. In this procedure, it is actually a breakthrough in fertility treatment for non-obstructive azoospermia, and it was first reported in 1999. In this, you visualize the testis under magnification. You sterilize the testis after giving an incision on the skin and tunica albuginea. Then you find an ovascular plane. There's a picture here. So the black dotted line is the line of the incision. You identify an ovascular plane, give a wide incision, and you split open the testis, and you're looking into the microscope, and you will just pick those tubules which appear dilated, bigger, and more opaque. you will not go for the smaller, thinner fibrotic tubules. You will see in the microscope and you will pick the dilated tubule, because the chance of finding a sperm in a dilated tubule is higher. And it is less damaging to the patient also. It is less damaging to the tissue. So this is how it is being done. The surgeon is looking into the microscope and is giving a big incision. The incision is big, but the damage to the testis is less in such cases, because everything is being done under vision. And after retrieving the tubule, the thicker tubule, it is handed over to the embryologist in the lab, and the embryologist will cut this tissue, tease it down, let the sperms come out. He will then examine under the microscope and he will confirm whether he found sperms or not. And sometimes the procedure can go on for 2 hours or 3 hours till the embryologist finds the sperms. You keep on checking the larger tubules. Now, after retrieving the sperms, now ICSI is the procedure. Now, a small needle is carrying one sperm and it is depositing the sperm inside the cytoplasm of a mature oocyte. The polar body there, down there, it tells us that it is a mature oocyte. So this is the procedure of ICSI. Now, this is the day 3 embryo after doing ICSI. And this is the way how embryo looks on day 3. And this is a day 5 embryo. This is a blastocyst. Now, this was the main things that we have, like micro dissection testing and all. No? It's been done a lot these days, and some of the people who are doing a lot of micro testing, they say that they can find sperms in whoever person has a testis inside him will have sperms also. So they are so confident that they can find sperms. But books report and the studies report that the chance of retrieving sperms with this technique is 50% to 60% in non-obstructive mesosperm. Now, there are, after doing all this, you know, IVF, ICSI, made embryos, but sometimes you've been successful and the patient gets pregnant, but you have the complications. Your successful treatment has gone bad. If your patient has ovarian hyperstimulation, the severe forms of hyperstimulation are even life-threatening, sometimes you have to terminate that pregnancy because of this problem. Another problem we see a lot with IVF, ICSI is multiple pregnancy. Because we are transferring 3 embryos, 2 embryos, so most of the patients will have twins or triplets. So this is not good, because it increases the risk of prematurity, it increases the maternal and fetal morbidity, mortality, and it increases the cost of treatment. The money spent on the premature babies is too much for the patients to bear. So this is not a success. A multiple pregnancy is not a successful IVF. A successful IVF would be a term single pregnancy without any complication to the mother and the baby. Now, how can we maximize the safety? How can we increase the success rate plus maximize the safety? So first and foremost is the lifestyle modification, because these days the couples who are coming to us, even the younger people, they are under a lot of stress. And most of them are obese, they are overweight, so these things are very important. Weight reduction and meditation, yoga, and taking life easy, because they would aid in fertility. Some patients would just get pregnant, even the 4-5 kg of weight loss, without any treatment they would get pregnant. So this is the first and foremost. We should always talk to our patients regarding this. And the second thing which can increase the safety is a single embryo transfer. If we practice this, we can minimize multiple pregnancies. But to be able to do a single embryo transfer, we should be able to choose the best embryo out of a pool of embryos, how to choose the best embryo. Now, there are certain things available with us. One is a pre-implantation genetic diagnosis. Now, this is the technique where you are taking one blastomere from an 8-cell embryo, and this blastomere is being checked for aneuploidy, translocation, and single gene disorders. But the drawback with PIGD is mosaicism. Sometimes this one blastomere, it may not represent the whole embryo. So PIGD has gone into bad light because of this. And even in a patient in which PIGD has been done, we need to confirm that everything is okay by chorionic villus sampling or by amniocentesis in the first or in the early second trimester of pregnancy. Because a normal PITD would never ensure that things are fine. Usually PITD is not routinely done in IVF practice. It's usually done in those patients who have a family history of some genetic problem and patients who have some diagnosis, who have had a DNA storage, they have some genetic diagnosis, previous miscarriages or repeated implantation failures. Those are the cases where PITD should be done. It's not a routine procedure for every IVF patient. Now, another important thing that we were talking about, freeze all embryos. Now, it has been noticed that the endometrium is altered during ovarian stimulation and the implantation is decreased in the stimulated cycle. So, elective freezing of all embryos with subsequent transfer is a good option and it is a solution to this problem. And another important aspect would be fertility preservation, especially in patients who are cancer patients who have to undergo radiation. And those females who do not want to have a baby before their career is set, you know, they don't want to marry, they've not found a suitable partner. What to do? Because their biological clock is ticking, you know. Time is not going to wait for them. So they have something available. There is something called oocyte freezing. Now, these people, cancer patients, and although technology has progressed a lot, but still we need to have more improvements in this technique. Oocyte freezing is not so well established as embryo freezing, because they say if you're freezing 10 oocytes, you may be able to get 2 embryos worth implanting from it, or 3 embryos. So you have to freeze 10 in order to get 2 embryos. So, but in the years to come, this would become better and we would have better freezing methods for oocytes also. Embryo freezing is, we do so much of embryo freezing, almost 20 to 30 cycles of freezing we are doing, and we are getting very good results. We have delivered so many babies and we've not seen any problems. In fact, the pregnancies, the patients who have conceived after embryo freezing, their antenatal period is very smooth. They would usually not have so much of problems. Then ovarian tissue freezing can also be done. The ovarian cortical tissue can be frozen. Another important aspect is we can administer an GnRH agonist in a patient who's receiving chemotherapy. That can, it temporarily makes the ovary inactive, it downregulates the pituitary, and it can save the ovaries to some extent. Now this news, I think people would have heard, former Miss World Anna Hayden in January 2006, she delivered a child at the age of 42. And this was a medical breakthrough because this baby was born out of eggs that she froze at the age of 32 years. So once oocyte freezing becomes widespread, you know, it will have assisted reproduction, will have a lot of applications in both infertile as well as fertile women. Just a few pictures, I think I've already crossed the timing. This is an immature oocyte. And there is one more thing which is we are listening these days is uterine transplantation and surrogacy. The first uterine transplantation was carried out in Sweden in, this is the first healthy IVF baby born in a transplant patient in 2014 in Sweden. And in India also we have done the first transplant in 2016. So this is it. They take out the uterus from a donor, from mother to daughter, or from some other donor, and they connect with the vagina and the internal iliac arteries, they're connected. But there are a lot of problems. We've also seen in the last lecture, we've heard immunosuppression and a lot of problems. Usually in such patients, after the baby is delivered, the uterus is removed by hysterectomy so that the patient doesn't have to undergo immunosuppression, has to take immunosuppression lifelong. The uterus is removed after the family is complete. Another important one, Dr. Suman asked me, what is this, a three-parent child, how is it possible? So this is, some ladies would have a mitochondrial DNA defect and they would pass on the defect to the baby. In such cases, this mitochondrial swap is a procedure which is done. Here we have two oocytes. From the mother oocyte, we are taking the karyoplast, the DNA, and from the donor oocyte, we are just taking the cytoplasm and mitochondria. And then you're combining the two and then fertilizing. So these are advanced techniques which we don't routinely do in small centers like ours, but these things are available, and people who have such problems, they can go to those places. Thanks a lot.
For some questions, if there are any.
How do you do two sides from the person, from the laparoscopically?
No, sir. Sir, once the ovary is stimulated, it becomes bigger. We can easily see on the ultrasound the anechoic follicles, round follicles. So we do it under ultrasound guidance, transvaginally. It is a very less invasive procedure. Just a needle goes through the vagina, and it is the needle is mounted on a TVS probe, and it's like a TVS with a needle which is mounted on the probe, and the needle goes into the follicles one by one. Just usually we do just one puncture on one ovary, and through one follicle we can enter the other, and then third one, then fourth one, like that. And then we get that aspirate that fluid from the follicle, jaise cyst aspirate karte hain, aise the fluid is aspirated, and then the embryologist will examine that fluid, and from that fluid he will take out the egg. It is a COC, it's a cumulus oophorus complex. So that is picked up. So all the fluid, whatever is retained from the oocyte retrieved, all the fluid is examined, and the eggs are picked up, and they are put to the culture media.
So procedure is just like bone marrow aspiration.
It's simple than that.
There is one question. A man who is azoospermic, undescended testis, who is the person, right person to be referred to under biopsy to be taken, FNAC under ultrasound?
Yeah.
By a surgeon or by your center?
Ma'am, the procedure should be done by a trained urologist, but he should have some facility for storage of the gamete. Okay. Or he can avail that facility in an ART center, because if he is able to retrieve some sperms, we may not be able to get it next time, you know. It should not be just a diagnostic procedure. We should offer sperm storage also, sperm freezing also, along with this.
Along
with this. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Suppose I referred a patient to urologist ABC. The person refused for FNAC. They sent it to pathology, and the pathology people refused.
Actually, so, FNAC is outdated now.
Okay.
Fertility specialists all over the world, they say FNAC should not be done for infertility.
Okay. So
in such cases, the ideal procedure would be a micro dissection SC, and it should be done by a trained urologist.
Okay. Thank you. Dr. Can you give some detail about the frozen embryo, if it is the embryo, they are the live tissues, how do you transfer the pregnancy?
Embryo vitrification is the most common method that is done these days, and normally when you freeze something, it would become dead if the water crystallizes. So the media that we have with us, they would make it like a glass. The water crystallization will not happen. The embryo will go into it will shrink. All the water will come out, because the media is hyperosmolar. The water will come out of the embryo, it will shrink. And then the vitrification media enters into the embryo, it expands again. There is no water inside a frozen embryo. It's just the media which will protect, which is a cryoprotected actually. Because when you are putting that embryo at minus 96, it will not damage the cell. And this cryoprotected loaded embryo is kept at minus 96 for, it can be kept for as long as you want.
Samadhi.
Yes, yes.
Samadhi. Prolonged samadhi.
Sleep hibernation. Better word.
Same is true for oocytes also.
Yes.
Maximum duration.
Yes. Same is true, but oocytes are more delicate. Embryo is a strong cell. It can withstand cryoprotectant and cryo, you know, frozen in minus 96. But oocyte is very delicate.
So what is the overall success rate of all these ART procedures in general? What is the percentage of
See, in a good patient, I would say in a normal responder, what I tell them, the success rate is 40 to 50% in a normal responder. But in a hyporesponder, the success rate would depend on what quality of embryo I am getting out of her. If I am getting good quality embryo, then success rate would say 20-25% in a fresh cycle. But our target in every patient, we should have adequate number of embryos so that we can freeze some, you know, because freezing a frozen embryo transfer cycle has shown to be a better results, you know, 50-20% higher results than fresh cycle.
Beyond that,
we cannot
go for this treatment.
See, in our country, lot of debate is going on. We have this ART bill pending. Things are, you know, till now we don't have an age limit because daily we read lady delivering at 80, 75 after IVF, you know. But the notification, the guidelines say that the combined age of the couple should not be more than 100 years. This is the guidelines, you know. Guidelines say ki dono ki umar milake 100 se zyada nahi honi chahiye. Zyada hai to IVF nahi karna, but there is no law as of now and we will have the law soon.
But fertility
rate
will be higher as the age advances.
What? Sorry?
Complication rate will be higher.
Complication. Obviously. Because at the higher maternal age, there are other problems, diabetes, hypertension, and as such, the body doesn't remain that strong. You know? They are high risk tendencies at higher ages.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am, for a very lucid presentation. But just like to ask one query about this with embryo freezing only. What is the appropriate age to counsel the patient about this embryo freezing? Like if we are seeing the patient in an OPD who is around 20-25, what should be the appropriate age to advise to just counsel her that it can be done?
Do you mean oocyte freezing? You mean oocyte freezing?
Sorry, yes, oocyte freezing.
See, I'll answer both your questions. Embryo freezing has to be offered to all patients who are coming for IVF. Whenever she is coming for assisted reproduction, she has to be taught about.
No, ma'am. If the patient is infertile patient, secondary, primary, then it is okay. But if unmarried girl is coming,
yeah,
in the OPD,
then it is oocyte freezing.
Yes,
see, it's a patient's choice actually. It all depends on her, but it's safe to be after she's attained 18 years of age, not before that.
After 18, right? We should
after
start telling about this.
No, we should not start telling.
This is
you
what
know?
My query is, what should be the appropriate
age? We don't tell.
Because patients are unaware about this procedure. Available.
No, we don't have to tell them. We don't have to give that message to the society that go for oocyte freezing. Because a naturally conceived baby is the best thing that you can have. And oocyte freezing will not guarantee that you can have a baby out of those frozen eggs. See, I told you oocytes are delicate. From 10 embryos frozen, you will get 2 good embryos. From 10 oocytes, you will get 2 good embryos. See, so we cannot guarantee that it ensures that you will preserve your fertility. But there are people who are not able to decide whether they want to marry at this age or no. And even if they are married, like, you know, Bollywood actresses, film stars, they don't want to have baby at 40 and 45. What do they do? It's for them. Yeah, this is for those, that subset.
And in this situation, if something bad happens, blood bird bar or something else, body causes, and they are frozen embryos in some of
the. So it's scary, the situation is.
The new generation will start from frozen. And a grandfather would be playing in the lap of the grandson.
Thank you so much. Thank you, ma'am, for the enlightening talk. I would like to request the chairpersons to kindly honor our speaker.